Hi, let's talk about the pericardium. In this video, we'll discuss how the pericardium is organized, its layers, and pericarditis. Now, the pericardium is a multi-layered sac which surrounds the heart. It has two distinct layers to it. The fibrous pericardium, which is the outermost rough and tumble layer, and deep to the fibrous pericardium is the serous pericardium, which is a serosal membrane that has two components. There is a parietal layer, which is fused to the fibrous pericardium, and then there is a visceral layer, which is fused to the heart directly, such that it is part of the heart wall. Now, between the parietal and the visceral layer is the pericardial cavity. In total, the pericardium is what defines the middle mediastinum. So anything anterior to the pericardium is the anterior mediastinum. Anything posterior to the pericardium is the posterior mediastinum. But wherever that pericardium is the middle mediastinum. That middle mediastinum is found below the sternal angle plane, which is approximately there. And it's also medial to the pleurae, which are lining the pulmonary cavities. Inferiorly, the pericardium is fused to the diaphragm, and so you'll have movement of the pericardium and the heart within as the diaphragm contracts and relaxes with respiration. What's nice about the pericardium is that it accommodates diastole, or the relaxation of the heart. As blood is all pressure driven, the heart through relaxation is able to move blood within it. So that fibrous pericardium is a collagen trilayer. Collagen is a very durable, very inelastic protein, and this trilayer is woven at right angles to itself. So it's a very tough, inelastic layer that represents the sum total of volume that the heart can hope to expand into. Now, deep to that fibrous pericardium is the serous pericardium. That serous pericardium, you can think of as a balloon. This is the metaphor that people like to explain any serosal membrane as. So if you can imagine blowing up a balloon and then, you know, punching your fist into it such that the balloon deforms around your fist. Now, there's a part of the balloon that is immediately touching your fist, and that's going to be the visceral layer of the serous pericardium. And then there's a part of the balloon that's not touching anything. And that's the parietal layer of the serous pericardium. And the space between, which isn't very much, is the pericardial cavity. Now, that serous pericardium has two distinct sources of innervation. The parietal layer, so that which is fused to the fibrous pericardium, is innervated by branches of the phrenic nerves. The visceral layer, that which is actually part of the heart and is superficial to some adipose connective tissue, fibroelastic tissue, and then deep to that, the myocardium, is going to be innervated by an autonomic plexus that innervates the heart, so the cardiac plexus. So the space between parietal and visceral pericardium with no innervation is the pericardial cavity. And again, this is not really so much a space as much as it is a potential space with a modest amount of pericardial fluid, which is an extremely powerful lubricant for within the heart. Now, the pericardium itself is supplied by blood by the pericardiacophrenic artery and vein. These are proximal branches of the internal thoracic artery and veins, and so they're going to run down between the mediastinum and the pleura. The pericardium, like any tissue, is subject to injury or pathological process, and if injured or if diseased, it can become inflamed, and this is a condition known as pericarditis. Pericarditis may be acute or it may be chronic. Acute is much more common. It's typically fewer than 6 weeks. And with this inflammation, there can be an imbalance of the resorption of pericardial fluid. And so the result of that can be what's known as a pericardial effusion. And there are different substances which can fill that pericardium, transudate, exudate, lymph can, blood can, so that would be a hemopericardium. And if there is a significant volume of effusion, so fluid accumulation within the pericardium, that can lead to a condition known as cardiac tamponade. With cardiac tamponade, the increase of fluid within the pericardium is going to exert pressure upon the heart such that the heart can't expand during diastole. And if the heart can't expand during diastole, the movement of blood into the heart is going to be compromised. And so pericarditis that leads to cardiac tamponade can be treated by a procedure called pericardiocentesis. With pericardiocentesis, if you can imagine, so that would be the xiphoid process, that would be the costal margins on either side. What happens is an individual takes a hypodermic needle attached to a syringe and they insert it between the xiphoid process and the costal margin. From the inferior to the superior. Now this is going to avoid the pleurae. It will go through the diaphragm inferiorly and through the pericardium, and one will be able to extract whatever the source of that effusion is and allow the heart the opportunity to participate in diastole as it typically would, while the underlying disease process can be addressed or the injury can resolve. That leads us to the assessment question of this video, and that is, which layer of the pericardium is part of the heart wall? The correct answer here is the visceral layer of the serous pericardium. That is called the epicardium. Keeping in mind that the fibrous pericardium and the parietal layer of the pericardium are fused together. And then between the parietal layer and the visceral layer of the serous pericardium, we have the pericardial cavity. The serous pericardium is all of the above, both parietal and visceral pericardium, but not fibrous pericardium. So, correct answer would be C, visceral layer of serous pericardium, or the epicardium for short. Thank you very much for your time.